Right, and I should start by saying something about my own path, the way I came to Buddhism and eventually ordained as a Buddhist monk in this particular tradition, and then to speak a bit more generally about being a Buddhist and being a Buddhist monk in the West, what it's like. Might be interesting for you to hear and compare it with your own life here in Asia, because the two are really different experiences in many ways. So I was born in what was then Czechoslovakia, now Czech Republic, 35 years ago. It was still the part of the communist bloc of countries. So when I was growing up, there was absolutely no information available on Buddhism, or generally on religion. It's very hard to find. And my parents were not particularly strongly Christian either. So I didn't really have much influence from that outside. But I was always interested in reading books and thinking about life and reading about other countries. So I was interested around the age of 12 and 13, already becoming interested in Asian culture. So that led me gradually to an interest in Buddhism as well. I picked up some books on that subject, but it was, as I say, very difficult to actually find books on the Buddhist teachings. Fortunately, I was already learning German since I was quite young. I was able to find some very old translations of the Pali texts in our local library. The translations were done like in 1890 by Neumann, who was a pioneer translator of the Majjhima-nikaya into German, so I was able to read that, and then also some old Czech books. So I had at least some idea about these early Buddhist teachings. And that was about when I was 15, 16. That's also when this communist regime collapsed, so the borders opened up and we were able to travel. Around that time, I got the address of the Buddhist Publication Society in Sri Lanka, and I've written to Venerable Bhikkhu Bodhi, who was the editor at that time of American Monk. And he was very kind and sent me many books for free, very good books on Theravada tradition, which made me very interested in studying more and also learning the Pali language, which I've done on my own, picked up some of the basics of the Pali language. And I also corresponded with Bhikkhu Bodhi, and he gave his time very generously to discuss some things with me. And then when I was 18, as a student, for the first time I went to England to visit the Amaravati Monastery, which is the biggest monastery of the Ajahn Chah tradition in Europe. And Ajahn Chah was the teacher. So I spent my summer holidays there. And then every year since then, I used to go and spend my summer holidays in this way, which was good. I could learn English and I could get familiar with the lifestyle there. It's a Buddhist monastery. One can just join the daily routine, the daily life. One can experience what it's like to live and work together with the monks and the nuns. Morning chanting, evening chanting, and meditation every day. Just to get a feeling for this kind of routine. And I really enjoyed that, really liked it. Then I also had a chance to spend time in the library there to study the books that I couldn't get easy access to at home. So that was very good for me. And then gradually later I studied philosophy but I couldn't really study the Asian philosophy or Pali. They didn't really teach that, so I was pursuing that interest on my own. And also slowly preparing my family for the fact that I really wanted to become a monk. Since I was about 17, I actually had that at the back of my mind that that's what I would like to do with my life. Because I couldn't really see anything more meaningful to pursue as a kind of career in my life. Actually, ever since I was quite like a young boy, I never felt so comfortable in the groups and group of my friends at school. I always felt a bit different and not really part of that society. I couldn't identify with the goals and the things that people in general regard as meaningful and worthwhile. I always felt a bit apart. So when I discovered Buddhism, that was like a good confirmation for me that, oh, that somebody, like the Buddha, he also felt like that, and he actually found a way out of that situation and found something meaningful to do in life. So that gave me an answer. And I found out it was still possible to live as a Buddhist monk in this day and age, even in the West. And found some inspiring examples. Got quite familiar with some of the monks. So one time when Ajahn Chah came to Czech Republic to teach, give some talks, I was translating for him. And I was at the university still studying. And he asked me, how long do you want to study for? Another few years or what? And I said, well, maybe my parents want me to finish this degree, MA or something, and they would be unhappy if I didn't finish my education. But really, I feel like ordaining as a monk. I don't see much point in getting any kind of degree. I'm not planning to use it for anything. So then he looked at me and said, well, don't you think it's a waste of time? And you can just come and ordain straight away. So I did. But when you're at the Buddha, I was determined. So when I came to the monastery in England, unlike maybe some of the other monks, some of the other people who arrived at a Buddhist monastery in the West, some of them maybe don't have much of an idea what it's really about, or don't have much background in Buddhism and Buddhist studies. I was actually on that level quite well prepared, so I didn't need to acquire much more knowledge on that level. But I had to, of course, learn how to live in a community with many other people. It's quite a big community in England, maybe 15 people on the main side, and there are the nuns also, at least 10 or more, and visitors, lay people staying there, coming for retreats. Quite a big place, really. But it's also a good place to learn about this community online and service, doing something for others. It's not the most quiet of places. There are a little more quieter places for meditation, but you can do retreats there. So it has its good side. So I started there as an anagarika, it's called in England. You basically keep the 8 precepts and dress in white, shave your head. And that's required to do that for at least 1 year to prepare yourself for the ordination as a novice, the samanera. They don't let you just jump in and ordain straight away, because what we found in the West is that the resources are quite limited and the accommodation is limited. It's not like in Asia where you have many traditional Buddhist countries, we have a temple in every village, and they have a hard time finding enough monks to live in these temples. In the West, it's quite difficult. You know, you have to invest a lot of time and effort into building and maintaining, repairing the monasteries. So there's also has to be a bit of like screening or quality control in terms of the people who you ordain there. Because if you just accept anybody, then a lot of people may not be so suited for this kind of life, especially life in a community where you need to live in harmony with others, work together. So that's why there is this slow process. Also, in these Western monasteries, we don't do the it's kind of temporary ordinations that are common in, say, Burma or Thailand. That's what you can do in these kind of ethnic Thai Burmese temples as well, but not in the Western monasteries, ordain just for a week or so. So we don't do that. So that's where I started in this way, and later I moved to Chidhurst Monastery, which was the first monastery in England that was established by the Western disciples of Ajahn Chah, who was the famous Thai meditation teacher, and he had many Western students and Westerners who came to ordain with him. This started about mid-1960s was when Ajahn Sumedho first came to stay with Ajahn Chah in Thailand. He was the first Western monk there, and it was quite hard at that time. There were some other Westerners who came to ordain in Thailand before that, but they generally did not stay very long. They left. And there was an attempt in England already, there were several attempts since the beginning of the 20th century to start some kind of a Buddhist monastery and a place for Theravada monks to stay there and practice, but it never really worked. And I think the reason why was that these different monks who perhaps were ordained in Asia and came back, they didn't have much grounding or much experience in living as a Buddhist monk. Maybe they had the right ideas, but not a lot of experience. And what you find is that in this kind of life that we live, it's not just about having good ideas or having the right kind of information. It takes much more than that. It's a kind of a complete lifestyle, way of life. That is based on the Dhamma Vinaya, that's the teachings of the Buddha, and these the rules and principles of monastic life that the Buddha laid down. And the Vinaya, that's not just like things, not just a list of prohibitions, like you can't do this, you can't do that. It's a very complete system, complete framework, which sets out the way of life, the style of life for somebody who is like a contemplative, somebody who is trying to find a way out of suffering in this very life, following the path that the Buddha recommended. And it's interesting that the Buddha actually spoke about this one time. He said in the past there were previous enlightened ones, previous Buddhas, and some of them did not lay down a complete sort of a code of conduct, a system of training for the monks, this kind of denial training. They just kind of left it up to the individual to maybe decide what's the best way to live as a Buddhist monk. They had the complete Dhamma teachings of these previous Buddhas. But because of this lacking framework, describing the particular way of life and how you should live together as a community, he said that the holy life, the Brahmacharya, is this whole Buddhist dispensation, Buddhist religion, we could say. It did not last very long. and some of these previous Buddhas. But on the other hand, he himself, he proclaimed a very complete and very detailed system of Vinaya, so describing the ideal way of life of Buddhist monks, a set of guidelines. And so that's some of these things was what the Western monks learned when they lived with Ajahn Chah. They learned how to live in a community. Of course, it was not so easy being in a very, very strange foreign culture. A lot of these Westerners were, some of them were soldiers in the Vietnam War, or they came to teach English in the East. Ajahn Sumedho was actually here in Malaysia teaching English to some Chinese kids somewhere in Sabah. And at that time he was actually trying to find out about Buddhism, but he couldn't find anything at that time in Malaysia. And it's interesting, his time in Malaysia, it actually started in Malaysia, and he had this contact with Buddhist culture, but I think the Chinese Buddhists here at that time didn't have much of an idea about the actual Buddhist teachings, maybe just some ceremonies. So he actually wrote to the Venerable Dhammananda, the chief priest at Brickfields Vihara in KL, and he sent him some books at that time. And that was one of the things that persuaded Ajahn Sumedho to go to Thailand later and pursue his interest there, and eventually to ordain and find this living monastic tradition and a teacher that could guide him. And that required, of course, learning another language gradually, slowly, but also learning just from the daily life in the monastery. Ajahn Chah, he could not speak more than a few words in English, but still he managed to teach the disciples in various ways. He was very creative. And I guess he had a lot of insight, like a psychological insight into the way the Western mind works. It was quite unusual because I think a lot of the Asian masters and teachers, monks, they do not have this kind of gift. They often misunderstand the Westerner. They don't quite know how we think. But somebody like Ajahn Chah, I think he was very flexible. He could actually understand how these people from another culture think and how he would need to teach them. So after some time, a number of Western monks have been living with him, and he suggested to Ajahn Sumedho that you should go and establish a monastery, kind of an international training monastery for these Western monks. And that's what Ajahn Sumedho did. I think he had been a monk for about 9 years at that time. And these Western monks started to live together in this community, which later became the Ajahn Chah in Thailand, the International Forest Monastery in Thailand. Many generations of Western monks have started there. But that in itself presented fresh sort of problems and difficulties, because it's another sort of thing to live with an enlightened master who has a lot of metta and kindness, and you admire him and you want to be around him all the time, and he answers all your questions. And of course you can project all of your hopes and ideas onto him, and sometimes it'll be frustrating, but at least you have this kind of great figure next to you. But Ajahn Chah actually did not encourage that kind of projections onto him. He would actually deliberately frustrate the Western disciples who wanted to kind of idealize him and treat him as a kind of guru and expect him to always be there for them, answer their questions. Ajahn Chah's style was more to kind of let people depend on themselves and learn from their own experience, even when the teacher is not around. you really eventually have to come back to your own experience, to all these different things, the lessons that life teaches us, and using the your knowledge of the Dhamma in a practical way to be able to deal with anything that happens in your life, all the positive and negative experiences we may have, just to learn from all these situations. So that's why Ajahn Chah said, like, you should be your own teacher. On the other hand, in Thailand there are many other teachers who actually prefer to these disciples to be very close to them and to depend on them and remain very close to the teacher. And a lot of the other monasteries, say in the forest traditions, we have very tightly knit communities centered around one leading figure. What would happen was that when that founding teacher died, they all collapsed, and these other places, those communities kind of dispersed and could not function after that. But say with Ajahn Chah, it was a bit different because he encouraged his disciples to actually go off on their own and start their own monasteries and their own disciples. So in this way, these monasteries spread throughout Thailand and then later abroad. They have many, a few hundreds, like 300 or more branches. So in that sense, Ajahn Chah's thought was more like encouraging the Sangha life. So the Sangha has a kind of strength of its own. It's not just dependent on one leading figure, like a kind of guru figure. But then, speaking about the Western community, of course there were difficulties, there were tensions, there were lots of misunderstandings between the Western monks and the Thai monks. Because a lot of these Thai monks in Northeast Thailand came from a very poor background, uneducated, couldn't speak English. And then they had to live together with these Westerners, a lot of whom were well-educated, and had a very different cultural background. So that's why we had this Western monastery established, especially for the Westerners. And then after a few years, it became possible to actually travel to the West, and some of the monks were invited to come and start monasteries in the West. In particular, the first one was Ajahn Chah, who was invited to England at the end of the 1970s. So there was this English Sangha Trust, an organization that has been trying for many years without much success to set up a place for Theravada monks to live in England. But as I explained, that it never really worked. Maybe the monks came and lived as a kind of teachers for a while, giving talks, lectures on Buddhism, but they themselves found it difficult to survive there. It just never quite worked. But in this particular case, it seemed to work, and Ajahn Chah gathered quite a few disciples around himself, and a lot of lay people became interested in this particular style of teaching, which was quite maybe different, which was based more on direct experience, meditation experience, not just like presenting theories and just talking on a very theoretical level, but talking more from experience itself. So it was a very successful start, and in England gradually there were more branch monasteries that developed, about five monasteries, and then it spread to Switzerland and Italy, and at the same time also in Australia something started. So gradually you can see the spread of this particular community of Western monks, and also nuns after some years. So the nuns order was started in response to the kind of expectations and needs of the Western society. So now looking back, where we are today in 2010, quite a long history already, we can see certain patterns maybe emerging. What is it like to live as a monastic, as a monk or a non Buddhist Theravada monk in the West, using this particular form, the Vinaya that we have from the Pali Canon, as a guideline for our lives. It's not easy, it has its challenges, certainly. You can see that from the fact that the first generation of monks, Western monks, from this Ajahn Chah tradition that came over from Thailand, they were like the senior monks and became the adults of the newly established monasteries. A lot of them have subsequently left the roads and returned to mainland. Especially after Ajahn Chah died, there was a big funeral, and I think there was a sense that like the teacher has left us. And I think a lot of them initially ordained because they had this great personal feeling of affection for him, admiration for a teacher, wanted to be near him, close to him. But when he passed away, then I guess they felt it's over, we don't have a teacher. And also there were definitely many challenges that arose in the Western community itself, you know, living together. Group of Western monks coming from all walks of life with different backgrounds, many different countries, nationalities together. How are we going to do things here in the West? It was a very, very strange situation, new situation, and there was no precedent to follow. Things had to be invented on the spot in response to the situations that arose. It was, a challenging situation. So, I think Ajahn Sumedho, so many challenging times. From the side of the lay people, of course, this kind of trust or association, they had to sort out their difficulties and disagreements. And when it was clear that what they wanted to support, then the monks had to come up with a kind of a viable model how to live together based on the Vinaya. But what they have learned in Thailand was actually often not directly, reading the scriptures, reading the Pali texts and learning from the text. The way it's often done in Thailand is that you kind of come and stay with a teacher, somebody, maybe a charismatic teacher, and you just follow the way he does it, you just copy whatever he does and the way he runs the monastery, the regulations of the monastery, you're just expected to fit into that kind of form. And that's quite normal, that's the normal way to do things in Asia, and in particular in Thailand. It's a society which is actually built up on this principle of seniority and hierarchy. At any sort of level of society in Thailand, you would expect to find somebody who's called like a puyai, like the big person, the superior person, and the punoi is the inferior, or the one who has to follow this superior person, and that guarantees a kind of social stability in the society, and everybody knows that, and he's grown up with that from school, and at work, everywhere. The whole society is just structured in this way. So even in a Buddhist monastery, you'll find that in Thailand, it's a very hierarchical setup. Every monastery needs to have an abbot, and he's basically running the show. he has a second monk who helps him, and everybody has to kind of follow that leading personality. And if you compare it to the monastic system described in the Vinaya, that's in the early, basically in the texts that come from the time of the Buddha, the way he described and set up the Sangha, the Buddhist monastic order, it wasn't actually like that. The Buddha in India at that time, you have to understand, they had several states, kind of sometimes they are called republics or confederations, different names for that. They had basically two main systems of government. One was there were some kings who were running their country, the monarchy, king was the ruler, and then there were these republics which functioned in a different way. They had an assembly hall where representatives of different families, maybe the clans, would come together, and they would make decisions together, a bit like in a parliamentary system. And the Buddha's own clan, Sakyans, they also had that kind of system. So maybe because of that influence, when he set up the Sangha, he did not set it up in such a way that, say, the Buddha was the leader and everybody had to follow what he said, and when he passed away, he would appoint a successor to be the leading one, and like a patriarch, a system of patriarchs, to lead the community. He set it up in a different way. He set it up in a way where every local community of monks living in a certain area, usually based around a village where they would all go to gather their alms food every day. So those monks living independent on that particular area or territory, they would naturally, stick together, and every 2 weeks they would gather for the Bosata observance day and recite the Patimokkha rules together to affirm their common standards, shared standards, the Vinaya, the basis of their monastic life. And they would make all decisions by consensus. And they would just discuss things amongst each other and come to decisions. They would distribute the duties. When there was a monastery, then the monks would share the duties amongst themselves. One monk would be appointed to look after the store, keeping things in order. Another monk would be appointed to arrange the dana invitations for the meals, a rota system. And another monk would do other things, be in charge of the lodgings, the accommodation. So it would all be shared in this way. There was no abbot of a monastery. It did not exist. Of course, there were senior monks and experienced monks who would command a kind of natural sense of authority, maybe, respect. But that's on a different level. It's more like somebody who could become a meditation teacher and would give good advice to the other ones. But on this level of, the organization of their life in this group, it would be based on this principle. But when you look at the history of Theravada Buddhism in Asia, the way it's changed over the centuries, I think it changed in response to the kind of prevailing social norms and customs. And you see that gradually that kind of very democratic, you could say democratic, set up of these independent communities living living together and sharing in common just this Dhamma Vinaya, these same principles, teachings and principles. I think that was not could not be really sustained because the different states in which Theravada Buddhism has spread in Southeast Asia, usually they were, of course, monarchies, they were kings, which were the rulers, and Buddhism was adopted as a national religion also. When you study the history of, say, Sri Lanka in particular, you will see that the kings there at some point adopted Buddhism or a particular sect of Buddhism and gave their support, material support to that particular group of monks. And they, you could say, they used also the religion to gain some sense of legitimation of their own political power. Support a religion, and you use these representatives of that religion to legitimize your own position in the state. You see that throughout Buddhist history in other countries, in Burma, in Thailand, everywhere. The later Buddhist texts that were composed, there were some Buddhist texts which describe, say, Buddhist cosmology, which described how the universe works, why people are born in a certain social position, why somebody is sort of predestined to be the king and another one is predestined to be the servant, and so on. That was all interpreted in these later Buddhist texts in this way. And kings, different Buddhist kings, also saw themselves actually sort of taking on a spiritual role. Some of these kings in Burma in particular, in Sri Lanka, also in Thailand, everywhere, they actually proclaimed themselves to be like bodhisattvas. So taking on this spiritual role and leading the whole population towards a brighter future. So all these developments take place, of course, in history. It's good to know about that. And to understand the reality, the current state of Buddhism in Southeast Asia. Because if we just open the books, the translated Pali texts as we have them, these days we have a lot of good translations. So we don't have the problem as, say, 100 years ago, we don't have accurate and readable translations of the Pali text. But if we just say open these books and then we say we live in England or somewhere like that and we acquire knowledge about the early Buddhist teachings from these books, you know, we come to Asia, to Asian countries, and we expect Buddhism here to correspond to those books, to those principles in those books, then we might be very surprised sometimes or shocked or just confused because it's often not like that. There's a lot of history behind Buddhism in Asia. And in particular when we ordain in this particular form as Buddhist monks, then we are joining the Sangha, the Bhikkhu Sangha, which has a long history. We can trace these ordination lineages teacher to teacher, very many centuries into the past. And yeah, that's the reality of it. And we see these different influences, social, political influences, how they have shaped the current state of the Sangha in Asia. But what happens, you know, when we transplant Buddhism into the West? Because in the West, we find ourselves in a completely different situation. Study probably history of Western civilization, the social changes that have taken place since the Enlightenment age, the French Revolution, the industrial revolution, like the whole the way the whole society has transformed, changed. There were some very major changes that took place in the modern Western society. Many values have been changed and re-evaluated. And the expectations and the assumptions of modern Western people can are quite different. So when we speak about religion in the West these days, in these modern developed countries, would be called first world countries, religion has lost that kind of role and place that it had, say, 150 years ago or more. Christianity mainly being the main religion in its various forms. There is no longer this kind of demand or expectation that everybody's going to be a Christian or to go to church on Sunday. Maybe there are some places, but a lot of these modern people growing up in these Western countries, they no longer feel a kind of obligation that they have to belong to this established body or some kind of church. And these days, say in Germany, you've got to belong to one church or another and pay the religious tax according to that, or in Switzerland it's the same. In Germany you actually have the option to formally leave the church and then you don't have to pay the taxes, keep your money. So a lot of people are doing that because there is no real compelling reason to stay as part of the church just because your parents were Catholic and you don't have to stay and pay your taxes to the Catholic Church. So a lot of people find that they have the freedom to choose their own religion if they want to be religious at all or spiritual at all. And so how do they choose? How do they go about choosing a religion? And why is it that Buddhism has become sort of the number one, the religion of most people's choice, the fastest growing religion in some countries? Well, it's because when you look at the Buddhist teachings, the principles of Buddhism as you find them in these early Buddhist texts, they are very attractive to the modern mind, people, educated people growing up in the West. There's even some quote of Albert Einstein that's been reprinted in many books. He's kind of predicted that Buddhism will become the religion of the future because it's not in conflict with science, for example, or scientific investigation of reality. It's not dogmatic. It's not based on the idea of like a personal God. So for many different reasons, the Buddhism is attractive, especially this idea of, a personal investigation of truth. It's something you have to discover for yourself. It's not a belief system. Most religions can be classified, described as systems of belief. You are led to believe in certain revealed truths. Believe in them, then you will be assured of some salvation. But in Buddhism, it's not like that. It's actually something that you have to kind of work with on your own, take it inwards, and have to discover for yourself. So these are the principles of Buddhism as we find them in these early texts. And when Buddhism is taught in the West, you also have to understand it's mainly taught through meditation practices and teachings. People come and join meditation retreats. They try to find some way to calm their minds, to gain some insight into the way their mind works. This is how people approach Buddhism. was interesting that when Ajahn Chah came to England and to America, he saw this and he said that, well, in Thailand normally we start from the other end of the Buddhist path. We teach about Dharma, generosity, then Sila, the moral precepts, and then Bhavana, the meditation, and at the end, those who are really determined, they also manage to come and sit in meditation. But on the most basic level, we start with generosity, offering food to the monks, and taking the precepts, where we keep them or not, but at least taking them. But in the West, he said, well, we can actually, it doesn't matter, we can start from the other end. We start with bhavana, meditation. Then when people come on a meditation retreat, and they want to sit many hours and meditate, they realize how restless and confused their minds are. They have to investigate what is the reason for this. And they find out, oh, maybe our lifestyle is not very wholesome, not very sort of virtuous. We need to work on our ethical conduct. We need to change the way we live our lives. So then we come down to the level of Sila. And then even more further that we realize, well, maybe we live in a rather selfish way, and a lot of people, especially in the West, are very kind of individualistic. It's an individualistic culture where families are very small, often just one, two children, and people live sort of much more individualistically than in Asia. So this idea of sharing and generosity and sort of feeding monks or houses is quite new. So then people also discover this level of Buddhist practice. And that really works. If you look at the way people come to the monasteries, say in England, in the West, and they first come to meditate, they think they can meditate, come on a retreat, and then slowly find out about other practices. Like they see the Asian people coming, offering food, so then next time they come, they also bring an apple or a sandwich. And then they see the people going through the ceremonies, taking the precepts, and so they read the translation and think, oh, maybe we should do that as well. But often they are quite reluctant to join in a big crowd doing this sort of ceremony together, because if they do it, they would rather do it individually by themselves, do it as a personal act of determination and resolution. So you see these cultural differences, but it actually works. It's already long enough, and you see a certain pattern emerging. There are whole generations of Western Buddhists who have grown up in very close contact with these monasteries in the West since they were young children. Now they are maybe young adults. And you can say that this is like the first generation of Western Buddhists, because their parents brought them, became themselves when they were teenagers. So that's quite encouraging. And one realizes that a lot of the forms that Buddhism takes on, kind of external forms, they need to be adapted, they need to be changed. There have been some attempts in the West to start completely fresh and without any direct transmission from Asia. Rather than going to Asia first to learn about monastic life in Asia, and then after several years coming back to the West, taking it over as a kind of living lineage, there were also some attempts to just start completely fresh in the West, just based on some information that you can read from the texts. But from what I've seen, these attempts have not been successful. They lack a certain depth or experience. There's a lot of trial and error happening. So what I've seen been most successful so far is a kind of a this gradual adaptation of something that, that one has learned in Asia, transplanting it to the West, and then adapting it, and this constant sort of dialogue with the Western culture, and taking these gradual steps, finding the form that fits the new environment. And there are challenges on the way, there are, you know, difficulties, certain turning points when things have to be changed in more drastic ways. But I think this will be a gradual process which still is going on. And it's only been 30, 40 years, so it's not such a long time yet. But when we will have, say, a few generations of Western Buddhist monks, Buddhist nuns who have actually mainly grown up in the West, then there will be a certain stability in this, say, in the Western Sangha emerging, and eventually that Buddhism can be regarded as fully domesticated in that new situation. There is a statement found in one of the commentarial texts, which describes, there's a king asked the question, you know, what can we regard Buddhism as being established in a new land, in a new country? And the answer that is given is, when a monk who is like the son of that country, born in that country, can learn, can ordain in that, in his own country, and learn the Dhamma Vinaya in that country, even in his own language, then you can regard a Buddhist tradition as being established in that country. So sometimes that takes a while, a few years, a few generations. So with a gradual accumulation of experience and knowledge and careful adaptation, we will see some positive fruits, and one is to be flexible enough to just respond to the needs of the society, not being so fixed on the, say, the mother culture of, say, a particular tradition that came from Asia, rather than thinking that we can just copy all these forms from, say, Sri Lanka or Thailand exactly in that way in the West. One has to be a bit, you know, careful and use wisdom. Use wisdom, rely on other people's experience, discuss it with other people who have experience, and gradually find a proper way, a proper form. Then we shall see some positive results. So I will just maybe stop here for now. I could, of course, tell you much more about the details of what it's like to live in the West as a monk. Maybe you have some questions that you would like to ask about that. I'm happy to reply to that.
Did anybody actually write down any questions? If they did, they can just pass them along and we can pass them to Bhante. Otherwise, if anybody wants to ask a question, you can just speak up.
So there's a question here, in what way are Westerners attracted to Buddhism? Yes, as I said, a lot of people come to meditation, they're just interested in meditation generally, and they don't think of themselves as Buddhists. They don't even want to call themselves Buddhists. They may actually be living very much in a Buddhist way. They are say they become vegetarians out of compassion to animals. They live their lives in a very moral way, with high ethical standards and all that, but there's some kind of reluctance among many Westerners to call themselves we are Buddhist, you know, because they compared it to, say, saying we are Christian or we are Catholic. They don't want to make a kind of statement of them. They belong to an organized church or group. So that's one thing you find, whatever. Then I'm just talking mainly about the Theravada Buddhism. I don't know so much about the others, but I think like the Tibetan Buddhist or Zen Buddhist may be a bit different. Like the way Tibetan Buddhism is often presented in the West, it's kind of they try to attract people by putting on a certain fashionable appearance, and it's not necessarily very Buddhist, what we call Buddhist, what they present. So you find all kinds of film stars and paranormal people proclaiming themselves as Buddhists, but I wonder how much they actually know about the Buddha's actual teachings. Maybe they are just attracted to some kind of a cultural form of Buddhism that appears attractive or appealing. But how they actually practice it, I'm not so sure. I think a lot of people, they did some kind of surveys in Europe and America, how many people call themselves Buddhists, and in the census they can actually make a statistic on this. And maybe a lot of, I don't know how many percent, but maybe a lot of those people who call themselves Buddhists, they would follow this category, that they don't actually know that much about the teachings of the Buddha, they just sympathize with some kind of Buddhist symbols, and maybe they like the Dalai Lama or something like this. It may not be very deep, but at least they are positive, and they like a religion that is peaceful, for example. They really dislike this kind of violent side of religion that, like, which Christianity is often presented to the world. So that's one big reason. Meditation, looking for something peaceful, some meaning in life. And also, as I said, it's kind of fashionable side of Buddhism. So we get many different reasons. So now there are a few similar questions here, basically about practicing as a layperson. Practicing as a layperson in daily life, and how do we cope with the stress of life, juggling in between work and family commitments, the anger and frustration that can arise in daily life. So that's the very old question, very old issue. Is there a difference between the life of a samana, somebody who has renounced the worldly life, the family life, and has chosen this, we call the brahmacharya, the celibate life of a monk or a nun? How does that differ from the life of a layperson who has a family and work and commitments? And that's, yeah, it's clear that there will be a difference. That's why the Buddha chose this way of life, living as a monk. And he recommended it for those who saw the urgency of this spiritual quest, for those who really wanted to like use their time, the time they have in this life, to resolve the problems, this kind of existential problem of the dukkha as quickly as possible. And you recommended, you know, that you can choose this way of life with a monk or a nun. And it frees you, it gives you a lot of time to devote to this kind of spiritual quest. And if you are, for whatever reason, cannot live like this, then one has to accept the fact that one's life will be more complicated. One will not have so much time and freedom to devote a lot of time to, say, meditation and study. One has to be ready for that, be prepared for that. Sometimes in the West, that's another thing, interesting thing. As I described, this Western society has changed in many ways recently. One of the things that happened is this, they call it like egalitarian attitude in society, assuming that everybody has got to like the same rights and fundamentally like the same position in society or same expectations. They should be treated in the same way. Say in America, this is quite strong, same rights. And sometimes this can be quite idealistic. And a lot of these Western Buddhists, especially like in America, they really don't like this idea of having two groups of Buddhists, the lay Buddhists, the normal lay people, and then the monks and nuns, who are supposed to be somehow more advanced, like a different caste. You know. They really don't like that idea, so that's why also the monastic tradition has not been established in America for so long, it's not so strong, because the society there doesn't seem to like it very much. In the sense of that you have two different paths, two different locations. They just like to assume that, yeah, you can live in any way you want, you can be a lay person, family, or not have family, go to work or not go to work, and basically you can all, you're like entitled where you have the same rights to experience Nirvana and become enlightened. Which sounds good, great, but perhaps a bit like idealistic and does not take into account the realities of life. And also the arkamma, the personal what makes us make this choice or that choice. Right? There is certainly some kind of influence coming from our past and why some of us have decided to become monks and nuns and others have decided to do a lay life. So just accepting that, there are these differences, and maybe these days actually in modern society people say that the lifestyle has changed so much that some lay people these days in the developed countries can actually arrange their lives in such a way that they just maybe work part-time or arrange just their daily life in such a way that they will have a lot of spare time left for Dhamma practice, meditation practice. You can go on retreats. It's if you know how to arrange your life, you can actually spend quite a lot of your time with Dhamma practice. So that's one possibility. And then in the daily life, like you say, family life, and all these challenges of work and so on, I think what's important is having this basis in Dhamma and Sila. Talked about it, these basic Buddhist principles, having a basically a positive attitude to life. Because a lot of the people in the West, because they lack this foundation of dana, generosity, they may feel they are kind of living slightly sort of selfish lives, maybe. They just think about myself and how I can sort out my situation, my life, my problems. very self-centered in that way. Whereas if you are more connected to other human beings through doing some form of service to others, joining other people, doing some kind of volunteer work, maybe practicing generosity in its different forms, not just giving food or financial support to whatever Buddhist temples, but you can give your time, you can give what is called the gift of fearlessness, the fearlessness of Hayadana. That's a very practical thing, you know, by behaving in such a way that nobody has to, that you don't pose any threat or danger to other people. That's a gift in itself, it's a form of generosity. And then the kind of influence will spread around you, other people will notice that. So being kind and not aggressive in the world, that certainly will help a lot. Having this kind of restraint in your physical and verbal actions, how you interact with people in the workplace or family. These are very important things. They will have definitely a positive result. And then, to the extent that you can, practice some form of meditation, mindfulness. At least trying to stay mindful during daily life, coming back to the physical experience of our bodies, doing a little walking meditation, sitting meditation if you can. And most important thing is always sort of checking in your mind, is my mind in a wholesome positive state? Is it kusala or is it akusala? Is it negative? Is it unwholesome? And establishing mindfulness in that way. And then improving the state of mind wherever you can. But first you need to have mindfulness to even notice it. And then learning from one's mistakes, wherever you see this brings good result, continue doing it. This doesn't bring good result, and trying to change your habits. All these things are a gradual ongoing practice. And really enable you to enhance your life, more positive, happy experience in life. So there's a question here. As you travel from monastery to monastery, you will come across different traditions, practices. Do you adopt some of the practices that are conducive to your liking or stick to your original practice? Do you always reflect on the Kalama Sutta to adopt their practices after you experience them? Yes, so I've lived in many monasteries in the West, but also in Asia. I visited Sri Lanka very briefly, and then mainly in Thailand, many different monasteries in Thailand, forest monasteries. And you see a certain variety, they are not all the same. And now coming to Malaysia is quite interesting because here's you are an Asian country, but there are different Buddhist traditions, different Theravada and Mahayana traditions that have arrived in Malaysia over the years and mixing here. So that's quite interesting to observe. You just follow the way he does it, you just copy whatever he does and the way he runs the monastery, the regulations of the monastery, you just expect it to fit into that kind of form. And that's quite normal, that's the normal way to do things in Asia, and in particular in Thailand. It's a society which is actually built up on this principle of, say, seniority and hierarchy. At any sort of level of society in Thailand, you will expect to find somebody who's called like a puyai, like the big person, the superior person, and the punoi is the the inferior or the one who is to follow this superior person, and that guarantees a kind of a social stability in the society, and everybody knows that and is grown up with that from school and at work, everywhere. The whole society is just structured in this way. So even in a Buddhist monastery, you will find that in Thailand it's a very hierarchical setup. Every monastery needs to have an abbot, and he's basically a brother to show. He has a second monk who helps him, and everybody has to kind of follow that leading personality. And if you compare that to the monastic system described in the Vinaya, that's in the early, basically in the texts that come from the time of the Buddha, the way he described and set up the Sangha, the Buddhist monastic order, it wasn't actually like that. The Buddha in India at that time, you have to understand, they had several states, kind of, sometimes they are called republics or confederations, different names for that. They had basically two main systems of government. One was there were some kings who were running their country, as the monarchy, the king was the ruler, and then there were these republics which functioned in a different way. They had an assembly hall where representatives of different families, maybe the clans, would come together, and they would make decisions together, a bit like in a parliamentary system. And the Buddha's own clan, these Sankhyans, they also had that kind of system. So maybe because of that influence, when he set up the Sangha, he did not set it up in such a way that, say, the Buddha was the leader, and everybody had to follow what he said, and when he passed away, he would appoint a successor to be the leading monk, and like a patriarch, a system of patriarchs, to lead the community. He set it up in a different way. He set it up in a way where every local community of monks living in a certain area, usually based around a village where they would all go to gather their alms food every day. So those monks living independent on that particular area or territory, they would naturally stick together, and every 2 weeks they would gather for the Bosata observance day and recite the Patimokkha rules together to affirm their common standards, shared standards, the Vinaya, the basis of their monastic life. And they would make all decisions by consensus. And they would just discuss things amongst each other and come to decisions. They would distribute the duties. When there was a monastery, then the monks would share the duties amongst themselves. One monk would be appointed to look after the store, keeping things in order. Another monk would be appointed to arrange the dana invitations for the meals, a rota system. Another monk would do other things, be in charge of the lodgings, the accommodation. So it would all be shared in this way. There was no abbot of a monastery. Did not exist. Of course, there were senior monks and experienced monks who would command a kind of natural sense of authority, maybe respect. But that's on a different level. It's more like somebody who could become a meditation teacher and would give good advice to the other ones. But on this level of say, the organization of their life in this group, it would be based on this principle. But when you look at the history of Theravada Buddhism in Asia, the way it's changed over the centuries, I think it changed in response to the kind of prevailing social norms and customs. And you see that gradually that kind of very democratic, you could say democratic, set up of these independent communities living together and sharing in common just this Dhamma Vinaya, these same principles, teachings and principles. I think that was not could not be really sustained, because the different states in which Theravada Buddhism has spread in Southeast Asia, usually they were, of course, monarchies, they were kings, which were the rulers, and Buddhism was adopted as a national religion also. When you study the history of, say, Sri Lanka in particular, you will see that the kings there at some point adopted Buddhism or a particular sect of Buddhism and gave their support, material support, that to that particular group of monks. And they used also the religion to gain some sense of legitimation of their own political power. Right? So support their religion, and you use these representatives of their religion to legitimize your own position in the state. You see that throughout Buddhist history in other countries, in Burma, in Thailand, everywhere. The later Buddhist texts that were composed, there were some Buddhist texts which describe, say, Buddhist cosmology, which describe how the universe works, why people are born in a certain social position, why somebody is sort of predestined to be the king and another one is predestined to be the servant, and so on. That was all interpreted in these later Buddhist texts in this way. And kings, different Buddhist kings, also saw themselves actually sort of taking on a spiritual role. Some of these kings in Burma in particular, in Sri Lanka, also in Thailand, everywhere, they actually proclaimed themselves to be like bodhisattvas. So taking on this spiritual role and leading the whole population towards a brighter future. So all these developments take place, of course, in history. It's good to know about that. And to understand the reality, the current state of Buddhism in Southeast Asia. Because if we just open the books, the translated Pali text as we have them, these days we have a lot of good translations. So we don't have the problem as, say, 100 years ago, we don't have accurate and readable translations of the Pali text. But if we just, say, open these books and then we say we live in England or somewhere like that, and we acquire knowledge about the early Buddhist teachings from these books, then we come to Asia, to Asian countries, and we expect Buddhism here to correspond to those books, those principles in those books, then we might be very surprised sometimes, or shocked, or just confused, because it's often not like that. There's a lot of history behind Buddhism in Asia. And in particular, when we ordain in this particular form as Buddhist monks, then we are joining the Sangha, the Bhikkhu Sangha, which has a long history. We can trace these ordination lineages from teacher to teacher, very many centuries into the past. And yeah, we just that's the reality of it. And we see these different influences, social, political influences, how they have shaped the current state of the sangha in Asia. But what happens, you know, when we transplant Buddhism into the West? Because in the West, we find ourselves in a completely different situation. Study probably the history of Western civilization, the social changes that have taken place since the Enlightenment age, the French Revolution, the Industrial Revolution, the way society has transformed, changed. There were some very major changes that took place in the modern Western society. Many values have been changed and re-evaluated. And the expectations and the assumptions of modern Western people are quite different. So when we speak about religion in the West these days, in these modern developed countries, what we call first world countries, religion has lost that kind of role and place that it had, say, 150 years ago or more. Christianity mainly being the main religion in its various forms. There is no longer this kind of demand or expectation that everybody's going to be a Christian or has to go to church on Sunday. Maybe there are some places, but a lot of these modern people growing up in these Western countries, they no longer feel a kind of obligation that they have to belong to this established body or some kind of church. And these days, say in Germany, you've got to belong to one church or another and pay the religious tax according to that, or in Switzerland it's the same. In Germany you actually have the option to formally leave the church and then you don't have to pay the taxes, keep your money. So a lot of people are doing that because there is no real compelling reason to stay as part of the church just because your parents were Catholic and you don't have to stay and pay your taxes to the Catholic Church. So a lot of people find that they have the freedom to choose their own religion if they want to be religious at all or spiritual at all. And so how do they choose? How do they go about choosing a religion? And why is it that Buddhism has become sort of the number one, the religion of most people's choice, the fastest growing religion in some countries? Well, it's because when you look at the Buddhist teachings, the principles of Buddhism as you find them in these early Buddhist texts, they are very very attractive to the modern mind, people, educated people growing up in the West. There's even some quote of Albert Einstein that's been reprinted in many books. He's kind of predicted that Buddhism will become the religion of the future because it's not in conflict with science, for example, or scientific investigation of the reality. It's not dogmatic. It's not based on the idea of a personal God. So for many different reasons, Buddhism is attractive, especially this idea of, a personal investigation of truth. It's something you have to discover for yourself. It's not a belief system. Most religions can be classified, described as systems of belief. You are led to believe in certain revealed truths. If you believe in them, then you will be assured of some salvation. But in Buddhism, it's not like that. It's actually something that you have to kind of work with. on your own and take it inwards and with the discovery of yourself. So that's how, and these are the principles of Buddhism as we find them in these early texts. And when Buddhism is taught in the West, you also have to understand it's mainly taught through meditation practices and teachings. People come and join meditation retreats. They try to find some way to calm their minds, to gain some insight into the way their mind works. This is how people approach Buddhism. It was interesting that when Ajahn Chah came to England and to America, he saw this and he said that, well, in Thailand normally we start from the other end of the Buddhist path. We teach about Dhamma, generosity, then Sila, the moral precepts, and then Bhavana, the meditation, and at the end, those who are really determined, they also manage to come and sit in meditation. But on the most basic level, we start with generosity, offering food to the monks, and taking the precepts, where we keep them or not, but at least taking them. But in the West, he said, well, we can actually, it doesn't matter, we can start from the other end. We start with bhavana, with meditation. Then when people come to a meditation retreat, they want to sit many hours and meditate, they realize how restless and confused their minds are. They have to investigate what is the reason for this. And they find out, oh, maybe our lifestyle is not very wholesome, not very sort of virtuous. We need to work on our ethical conduct. We need to change the way we live our lives. So then we come down to the level of Sila. And then even more further that we realize, well, maybe we live in a rather selfish way, and a lot of people, especially in the West, are very kind of individualistic. It's an individualistic culture where say, families are very small, often just one, two children. And people live sort of, much more individualistically than in Asia. So this idea of sharing and generosity and sort of feeding monks and Ajahn is quite new. So then people also discover this level of Buddhist practice. And that really works. If you look at the way people come to the monasteries, say in England, the West, and they first come to meditate, they think they can meditate, come on a retreat, and then slowly find out about other practices. Like they see the Asian people coming, offering food, so then next time they come, they also bring an apple or a sandwich. And then they see the people going through these ceremonies, taking the precepts, and so they read the translation and think, oh, maybe we should do that as well. But often they are quite reluctant to join in a big crowd doing this sort of ceremony together, because if they do it, they would rather do it individually by themselves, do it as a personal act of determination and resolution. So you see these cultural differences, but it actually works. It's already long enough, and you see a certain pattern emerging. There are whole generations of Western Buddhists who have grown up in very close contact with these monasteries in the West since they were young children. Now they are maybe young adults. And you can say that this is like the first generation of Western Buddhists, because their parents brought them, became themselves when they were teenagers. So that's quite encouraging. And one realizes that a lot of the forms that Buddhism takes on, kind of external forms, they need to be adapted, they need to be changed. There have been some attempts in the West to start completely like fresh and without any direct transmission from Asia, rather than going to Asia first to learn about monastic life in Asia, and then after several years coming back to the West, taking it over as a kind of living lineage. There were also some attempts to just start completely afresh in the West, just based on some information that you can read from the text. But from what I've seen, these attempts have not been successful. They lack a certain depth or experience. There's a lot of trial and error happening. So what I've seen being most successful so far is a kind of this gradual adaptation of something that one has learned in Asia, transplanting into the West, and then adapting it. This constant sort of dialogue with the Western culture, and taking these gradual steps, finding the form that fits the new environment. And there are challenges on the way. There are difficulties, certain turning points when things have to be changed in more drastic ways. But I think this will be a gradual process which still is going on. And it's only been 30, 40 years, so it's not such a long time yet. But when we will have, a few generations of Western Buddhist monks, Buddhist nuns who have actually mainly grown up in the West, then there will be a certain stability in this, say, in the Western Sangha emerging, and eventually that Buddhism can be regarded as fully domesticated in that new situation. There is a statement found in the in one of the commentarial texts, which describes, there's a king asked the question, what can we regard Buddhism as being established in a new land, in a new country? And the answer that is given is, when a monk who is like the son of that country, born in that country, can learn, can ordain in his own country and learn the Dhamma Vinaya in that country, in his own language, then you can regard a Buddhist tradition as being established in that country. So sometimes that takes a while, few years, few generations. So with a gradual accumulation of experience and knowledge and careful adaptation, we will see some positive fruits. And one has to be flexible enough to just respond to the needs of the society, not being so fixed on the mother culture of, say, a particular tradition that came from Asia, rather than thinking that we can just copy all these forms from, say, Sri Lanka or Thailand exactly in that way in the West. One has to be a bit careful and use wisdom. Use wisdom, rely on other people's experience, discuss it with other people's experience, and gradually find out the way of the problem. Then we shall see some positive results. So I will just maybe stop here for now. I could, of course, tell you much more about the details of what it's like living in the West as a monk. Maybe you have some questions that you would like to ask about that. I'm happy to reply to that.
Did anybody actually write down any questions? If they did, they can just pass them along and we can pass them to Bhante. Otherwise, if anybody wants to ask a question, you can just speak up. Have you seen the question?
Okay.
Chinese? Or
So there's a question here. In what way are Westerners attracted to Buddhism? Yes, as I said, a lot of people come to meditation. They're just interested in meditation generally, and they don't think of themselves as Buddhists. They don't even want to call themselves Buddhists. They may actually be living very much in a Buddhist way. They are, say, become vegetarians out of compassion to animals. They live their lives in a very moral way, with high ethical standards and all that, but there is some kind of reluctance among many Westerners to call themselves the Buddhists, you know, because they compare it to, say, saying we are Christian or we are Catholic. They don't want to make a kind of statement of them. They belong to an organized church or group. So that's one thing you find, whatever. Then I'm just talking mainly about the Theravada Buddhism. I don't know so much about the others, but I think like the Tibetan Buddhist or Zen Buddhist may be a bit different. Like the way Tibetan Buddhism is often presented in the West, it's kind of they try to attract people by putting on a certain fashionable appearance, and it's not necessarily very Buddhist or Buddhist that they present. So find all kinds of film stars and paranormal people proclaiming themselves as Buddhists, but I wonder how much they actually know about the Buddha's ancient teachings. Maybe they are just attracted to some kind of a cultural form of Buddhism that appears attractive or appealing. But how they actually practice it, I'm not so sure. I think a lot of people, they did some kind of surveys in Europe and America, how many people call themselves Buddhists, and in the census they can actually make a statistic of this. And maybe a lot of, I don't know how many percent, but maybe a lot of those people who call themselves Buddhists, they would fall into this category that they don't actually know that much about teachings of the Buddha, they just sympathize with some kind of Buddhist symbols, and maybe they like the Dalai Lama or something like this. It may not be very deep, but at least they are positive, and they like a religion that is peaceful, for example. They really dislike this kind of violent side of religion that, like, which Christianity is often presented to the world. So that's one big reason. Meditation, looking for something peaceful, some meaning in life, and also, as I said, this kind of fashionable side of Buddhism. So we have many different reasons. So now there are a few similar questions here, basically about practicing as a layperson. Practicing as a layperson in the daily life, and how do we cope with the stress of life, juggling in between work and family commitments, the anger and frustration that can arise in daily life. So that's the very old question, very old issue. Is there a difference between the life of a samana, somebody who has renounced the worldly life, the family life, and has chosen this, we call the brahmacharya, the celibate life of a monk or a nun? How does that differ from the life of a lay person who has a family and work and commitments? And it's clear that there will be a difference. That's why the Buddha chose this way of life, living as a monk. And he recommended it for those who saw the urgency of this spiritual quest, and for those who really wanted to use their time, the time they have in this life, to resolve the problems, this kind of existential problem of your dukkha as quickly as possible. And he recommended that you can choose this way of life, a monk or a nun, and it frees you, it gives you a lot of time to devote to this kind of spiritual quest. And if you are, for whatever reason, you cannot live like this, then one has to accept the fact that one's life will be more complicated, one will not have so much time and freedom to devote a lot of time to meditation and study. One has to be ready for them, one has to be prepared for them. Sometimes in the West, that's another thing, interesting thing. As I described, this Western society has changed in many ways recently. One of the things that happened is this, they call it like egalitarian attitude in society, assuming that everybody has got the same rights and fundamentally the same position in society or same expectations. They should be treated in the same way. Say in America, this is quite strong, same rights. And sometimes this can be quite idealistic. And a lot of these Western Buddhists, especially in America, they really don't like this idea of having two groups of Buddhists, the lay Buddhists, the normal lay people, and then the monks and nuns, who are supposed to be somehow more advanced, like a different caste. They really don't like that idea, so that's why also the monastic tradition has not been established in America for so long, it's not so strong, because the society there doesn't seem to like it very much. In the sense of that you have two different paths, two different vocations. They just like to assume that, you can live in any way you want. You can be a lay person, you can have family, a monk family, go to work or not go to work. And basically, you're like entitled where you have the same rights to experience Nirvana and become enlightened. Sounds good, great, but perhaps a bit like idealistic and does not take into account the realities of life. And also our karma, the personal karma, what makes us make this choice or that choice. There is certainly some kind of influence coming from our past and why some of us have decided to become monks and nuns and others have decided to do a lay life. So just accepting that, there are these differences, and maybe these days actually in modern society, people say that the lifestyle has changed so much that some lay people these days in the developed countries can actually arrange their lives in such a way that they just maybe work part-time or arrange just their daily life in such a way that they will have a lot of spare time left for Dhamma practice, meditation practice. You can go on retreats. If you know how to arrange your life, you can actually spend quite a lot of time with Dhamma practice. So that's one possibility. And then in the daily life, like you say, family life, and all these challenges of work and so on. I think what's important is having this basis in Dharma and Sila. We talked about it, these basic Buddhist principles, having basically a positive attitude to life. Because a lot of the people in the West, because they lack this foundation of Dharma, generosity, they may feel they are kind of living slightly sort of selfish lives, maybe. They just think about myself and how I can sort out my situation, my life, my problems. They are very self-centered. Whereas if you are more connected to other human beings through doing some form of service to others, joining with other people, doing some kind of volunteer work, maybe practicing generosity in its different forms, not just giving food or financial support to whatever Buddhist temples, but you can give your time, you can give what is called the gift of fearlessness, the fearlessness of Hayadana. That's a very practical thing, you know, by behaving in such a way that nobody has to, that you don't pose any threat or danger to other people. That's a gift in itself, it's a form of generosity. And that the kind of influence will spread around you, other people will notice that. So being kind and not aggressive in the world, that certainly will help a lot. Having this kind of restraint in your physical and verbal actions, how you interact with people in the workplace or family. These are very important things. They will have definitely a positive result. And then, to the extent that you can, practice some form of meditation, mindfulness, at least trying to stay mindful during daily life, coming back to the physical experience of our bodies, doing a bit of walking meditation, sitting meditation if you can. And the most important thing is always sort of checking in your mind, is my mind in a wholesome positive state? Is it kusala or is it akusala? Is it negative? Is it unwholesome in some form or another? That's, and you know, establishing mindfulness in that way. And then improving the state of mind wherever you can. But first you need to have that mindfulness to even notice it. And then learning from one's mistakes, whatever you see, this brings good result, continue doing it. This doesn't bring good result, and trying to change your habits. All these things are a gradual, ongoing practice. And will enable you to enhance your life, more positive, happy experience in life. So there's a question here. As you travel from monastery to monastery, you will come across different traditions, practices. Do you adopt some of the practices that are conducive to your liking or stick to your original practice? Do you always reflect on the Kalama Sutta to adopt their practices after you experience them? Yes, so I've lived in many monasteries in the West, but also in Asia. I visited Sri Lanka very briefly, and then mainly in Thailand, many different monasteries in Thailand, forest monasteries mainly. And you see a certain variety. They are not all the same. And coming to Malaysia is quite interesting because here's you are an Asian country, but there are different Buddhist traditions, different Theravada and Mahayana traditions that have arrived in Malaysia over the years and mixing here. So that's quite interesting to observe. And how the Malaysian Buddhists have also in their way chosen what works and try to adapt that to their environment here, their context. So myself, I guess I have some foundation of my own practice that is based on my the study of the Dhamma Vinaya, the Buddhist texts. Then, which is just independent really, that's what I've done on my own. I haven't learned from anybody else. But then also I've tested some of these teachings that I've read about. I've also tested them in practical situations, daily life situations, living as a monk in the West and in the East. So, rather than, say, becoming very strongly